Hello. It is with great excitement we welcome you to the Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Summer Seminar Series. The Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Disease and Movement Disorder Centers provide innovative, multidisciplinary care for patients and families affected by Parkinson's disease and other movement disorders. The center's care team works to promote health, education, and support for patients, care partners, and family members. We achieve this through a patient-centered approach to the management of Parkinson's disease that includes rehabilitation, wellness, and support services in the comfort of your community. You may find comprehensive movement disorder care at three Northwestern Medicine hospitals, including Northwestern Memorial Hospital, Northwestern Medicine Central DuPage Hospital, and Northwestern Medicine Lake Forest Hospital. Thank you for joining us and our distinguished panel of speakers. We hope this seminar series provides an opportunity for education, inspiration, and motivation.
Hi, my name is Susie Krieger, and I'm a member of the Northwestern Medicine Lake Forest PD Support Group, and I have been for 4 years. During that time, I've also had the opportunity to facilitate the care and share section of the support group meeting. During care and share, we break out the people with Parkinson's for a discussion separate from the caregivers and care partners. We bring a lot of different things to the table. We come from a number of different walks of life, but like I always say, Parkinson's is the great playing field leveler, and we all do have a lot to learn from each other. The support group is reinforced by a variety of PD-specific exercise classes. We are a competitive bunch. When we're not restricted by COVID rules, there are approximately 20 classes per week, Monday through Friday. This is so important because exercise is our best weapon for slowing down disease progression. When we participate in the annual 5K run walk, known as Race to Impact, we are known as Team Tenacity because we are tenacious. Whether you are newly diagnosed or have been navigating the disease for a long time, 17 years in my case, it's a fact that you'll need a movement disorder specialist. This type of neurologist will see many more PD patients and therefore have a broader view of what works and what does not. The MDS will be up on all the latest pertaining to Parkinson's and also be aware of what's in the pipeline. They'll have a passion for helping and have compassion for the person with Parkinson's. Since there is no cure yet, the best we can do is keep moving and use the right mix of medications developed to provide a better quality of life in the meantime. Any meds that work in your brain require a prescriber who pays very close attention to his patient. It's like walking a tightrope. Without enough of a med, you may not be able to function as you'd like, but going slightly over that dose can actually cause some symptoms it was meant to alleviate. The patient needs to keep track and communicate, and the doctor must be a good listener. We are sometimes slow to get thoughts together and words out. He or she must be patient and allow enough time for the person with Parkinson's to speak. To sum it up, we're looking for a movement disorder specialist who is knowledgeable of all the facets of the disease, is a proponent of exercise, is a wizard with complicated meds, has a passion for helping people, each with their own unique set of symptoms, has compassion for what that individual faces daily, is a good listener, is a good communicator, and a person you look forward to seeing. This describes our next speaker, my doctor, Dr. Avram Fraint.
I'd like to thank everyone for watching my talk entitled Cannabis and Parkinson's Disease. I am Avram Fraint. I'm a movement disorders neurologist at Northwestern Medicine Lake Forest Hospital. So let's talk a little bit about the background of cannabis. It's actually been used as a medication for a long time, over 2,500 years. There's ancient tombs in China which have been excavated and found to include large amounts of preserved cannabis. Cannabis was actually brought to the Western world from India in the 19th century. The endocannabinoid system, and from here on out I'll be using ECS, modulates a range of physiologic functions. And this system is the system of neurotransmitters and neurons on which cannabis and cannabis-containing products act. The system modulates things like mood, cognition, motor control, appetite and feeding, and also pain. And there's already many cannabis-based products approved and in use for various clinical indications, including pain, anorexia, spasticity, nausea related to chemotherapy, and even epilepsy. And there's even some evidence that suggests that cannabinoids might be neuroprotective. And in the context of Parkinson's, that may mean slowing the progression of the disease or somehow modifying the progression of the disease. Cannabis is actually still considered a Schedule I controlled substance. Some of the criteria for Schedule I controlled substances include a lack of a currently accepted medical use in the United States, which, as I mentioned on one of the previous slides, is not exactly true right now for cannabis. Similarly, lack of an accepted safety for use under medical supervision and high potential for abuse. Other Schedule I substances include heroin, LSD, and MDMA. So how prevalent is cannabis use in the United States? Well, there was one study completed in 2016. This was a community-based epidemiological survey that asked respondents to report their past year use of cannabis. So the overall prevalence of past year use in this cohort was about 14%. But as I think we would expect, the rate of use decreased as age increased. So in other words, younger patients or younger respondents were more likely to report cannabis use, whereas older patients or older respondents were less likely to report use of cannabis in the previous year. So what is cannabis? It's actually a pretty complicated medication or substance, depending on how you look at it. It contains over 400 different chemical compounds. THC is the main psychoactive component. The other major component is CBD. So I think a lot of people might be a bit confused about the differences between THC and CBD. I think generally this dichotomy is effective. Again, the THC is the part that makes people quote-unquote high, whereas CBD has some other impacts on the pharmacokinetics of THC, but is not considered to give you that high. So people have already come to me saying that they're using things like CBD ointments or oils, which just rub into the skin and don't have any of the psychoactive effects. But having said that, CBD might actually modulate or impact the pharmacokinetics or the psychoactive activity of THC. So why is there all this fuss about cannabis in Parkinson's disease, and why might it work? Well, from a chemical standpoint, the endocannabinoid system, or the ECS, is really highly represented in the basal ganglia. The basal ganglia is the part of the brain which is impacted in Parkinson's disease. There are certainly other parts of the brain that are impacted in Parkinson's disease, but we think of the basal ganglia as being sort of ground zero for what causes the symptoms and signs of Parkinson's disease. And there's two primary receptors in the cannabinoid system, and they're called CB1 and CB2. CB1 is really heavily distributed within the basal ganglia, and in fact, it's actually the second most commonly found receptor in the central nervous system. The central nervous system includes the brain and the spinal cord. The other cannabinoid receptor subtype is called CB2, and that is present in the immune system. It modulates inflammation, and it's also present, but to a lesser degree, in the basal ganglia. Again, the part of the brain which we think of as really being responsible for causing the signs and symptoms of Parkinson's. We also know that the ECS is altered in movement disorders, not just Parkinson's disease, but definitely including Parkinson's disease. And there's some preclinical research in animal models that shows that if you modulate, that modulation of the cannabinoids could actually improve some of the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease, particularly dyskinesia. So in other words, when you give animals Parkinson's disease and then you cause them to have dyskinesia, it seems like there's something abnormal about the receptors, the CB1 and CB2 receptors, but it's unclear if this is a compensatory finding or a causal finding. So we don't know if this modulation is caused by Parkinson's or if having Parkinson's is what leads to this abnormal receptor activity. So this is a bit of a confusing slide, but I would like to draw your attention to the figure on the right side. So the big yellow neuron that says DA, that's a dopamine-producing neuron. The little yellow circles are little dopamine molecules. The green circles are cannabinoid molecules. And then if you look on the dopamine cell, there's this kind of green squiggly line, and that's a cannabis receptor. On the blue neuron that says GABA, there's another blue sort of squiggly line on the surface of that circle, and that's the CB1 receptor. So again, the blue is the CB1 receptor, the green is the CB2 receptor, and you can see that there's interaction and communication between these different cell types, different cell molecules, and cell receptors. So the point of this figure is really just to show that we know on a biochemical level that the cannabis system and the dopamine system are highly integrated. There's lots of communication between these systems. So it stands to reason that modulation of one system or the other would have an impact on dopamine transmission, potentially dopamine production, and dopamine utilization, which are really the things that we're trying to impact when we treat Parkinson's disease with our existing medications. So we know now why there are physicians like me and biochemists interested in cannabis and Parkinson's disease, but why are so many patients interested? And they really are. This is probably the most commonly asked question in my clinic. I'm not going to show this video now, but this is probably a video that many patients have seen. This is a patient with Parkinson's disease, and at the beginning of the video, he's got lots of tremor, lots of stiffness and slowness, and he indicates that he can't tolerate prescription medications for Parkinson's disease due to side effects. And then they show him about 30 minutes after smoking some cannabis, and his symptoms have basically all completely resolved. And I do recommend that patients go and watch this because it is a pretty compelling video. So let's kind of change gears and focus on, you know, what do movement disorders clinicians already know about Parkinson's disease and cannabis? So this was a really interesting study that was actually done. The first author is Dr. Danny Bega, who's a movement disorders neurologist downtown, one of my colleagues. And so this study actually sent a survey to multiple movement disorders trained neurologists just to ask them, what do you know about the literature and use of cannabis in treating your patients with Parkinson's disease? So if you look at this graph, this shows the expected effect of cannabis by symptom. So in other words, physicians were asked about the extent to which they expected cannabis to improve or make worse these various Parkinson's symptoms. So if you look to the left at things like appetite, pain, nausea, anxiety, the majority of physicians expected that cannabis would improve these things. There were some positive effects expected for things like tremor and rigidity and dyskinesia. So in other words, the motor symptoms of Parkinson's disease. These Parkinson's physicians expected that those things may improve. But then when it came to things like fatigue, motivation, sleepiness, balance, forgetfulness, hallucinations, it was expected that these things might get worse with use of cannabis. Here is a graph that shows the extent to which the respondents thought the literature supported use of cannabis, again, based on symptom. So it was expected that use of cannabis might improve nausea, anxiety or pain, but it was less expected, or these physicians were less confident in the extent to which the literature supported use for cannabis in treatment of tremor and dyskinesia. So again, there seems to be some kind of general consensus or belief that cannabis helps things like nausea, anxiety, and pain, and that there's literature to support these things. But when it comes to the motor symptoms, there was less confidence that the literature supported it. And I think the reason is, and we'll get into this later, that we know in non-Parkinson studies that there is good evidence for cannabis to improve things like nausea, anxiety, and pain. But there's no, or at least much fewer studies looking specifically at Parkinson's motor symptoms and how they respond to cannabis. So this is a slide that looks at belief about possible negative effects. So most people, most respondents agreed that they thought that cannabis use might worsen things like short-term memory, long-term memory, and executive function. Most respondents did not think that there was a high potential for overdose on cannabis, but similarly, or at the same time, there was a decent amount of agreement that there was an addictive potential for cannabis. Here, this is an indication of where are these movement disorders, neurologists looking for information about cannabis. Well, thankfully, a good number of respondents were looking at medical literature, but then some people were using personal experience and what they their patients had reported to them. Interestingly, I thought this was pretty surprising. Only 23% of respondents reported any previous formal education about cannabis. So certainly this indicates that there's a gap in our education and our knowledge about use of and response to cannabis. So I apologize for the small writing here, but I thought it would be helpful to go through the existing research on cannabis in certain psychiatric disorders, because many of our Parkinson's patients also deal with psychiatric issues. So rather than using more kind of traditional pharmacologic interventions, maybe we could use this data and sort of extrapolate it to some of our patients. So here shows two studies of patients with anorexia, the first done in 1983, the second done in 2014. The initial study actually compared THC to diazepam, which is a anxiety-reducing medication, and there was no significant difference in weight gain between those two groups. However, a study in 2014 comparing dronabinol, which is another cannabis-containing product in a pill form, when that was compared to placebo, there was a significant weight gain in the dronabinol group compared to the placebo group. So another very wordy slide here, but these are multiple studies looking at cannabis-containing products in treatment of anxiety. So, you know, there's, I would say, mixed results, but I think overall a trend toward a reduction in anxiety with cannabis-containing products compared to placebo. Here's one study about using cannabis-containing product compared to placebo in PTSD, which did show significant improvement in many of the symptoms of PTSD. And then when looking at psychotic symptoms, comparing CBD to an anti-nausea medication, there were really no significant differences between the different treatment groups, although the CBD group had fewer side effects. So what about in other neurologic conditions? Well, it's actually been studied in Alzheimer's, in dementia, and even in ALS. So interestingly, in the Alzheimer's population, the cannabis-containing product did show a decreased severity of disturbed behavior compared to placebo. In one study done in 2011 looking at patients with non-Alzheimer's types of dementia, there was reduced nighttime agitation and improvement in circadian rhythms in this one study that compared dronabinol to placebo. But unfortunately, in the two remaining dementia studies and in the ALS study, there was no significant difference in the THC group compared to the, or in the cannabis-containing product group compared to placebo groups. So kind of honing in a little bit closer on our Parkinson's population, what about cannabis and other movement disorders? So in dystonia, which is an abnormal and involuntary contraction of some muscles, there was no significant change when comparing cannabis-containing products to placebo. And then looking at Huntington's disease, one study done in 1991 comparing CBD to placebo showed no significant difference in chorea severity. One study done in 2009 showed that nabilone, again another cannabis-containing product compared to placebo, did show a significant treatment effect on the motor symptoms, particularly the chorea subscale, when compared to placebo. But interestingly, there was no difference in low-dose cannabis-containing product versus high-dose, 1 milligram versus 2 milligram, that is. But both groups had a benefit compared to placebo. And then a final study, another Huntington study done in 2016, which did not show a benefit for the cannabis-containing product compared to placebo. So what about Parkinson's disease, which is obviously what everyone's waiting for? So this is a list of multiple studies that have already been done in Parkinson's disease looking at the effect of cannabis, and I'm going to get into some of the bigger studies in more detail. But I think it's important here to sort of differentiate survey studies from case control or placebo-controlled trials. So the survey studies are basically just respondents answer questions that are asked to them, whereas placebo-controlled trials are considered kind of the gold standard from which we can draw conclusions. But the top study looked at 84 patients, and 46% of them, so almost half, reported some benefit. So about a third reported an improvement in the rest tremor, 45% reported an improvement in bradykinesia, and 14% reported an improvement in levodopa-induced dyskinesia. So let's get into some of the individual studies here. So I actually had one question that was submitted asking about use of cannabis for sleep. So this was a pretty small study that looked at that issue, but it looked specifically at cannabis use in treatment of REM behavior sleep disorder. So this is the sleep issue that many patients with Parkinson's have, often before they're ever diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, in which they're yelling in sleep, thrashing, kicking, sometimes injuring bed partners, sometimes falling out of bed and injuring themselves. And this study, again, only 4 patients, but they were given a component of a cannabis sativa plant. So that's one of the 2 strains or the 2 types of cannabis that can be used. And actually, these 4 patients reported a pretty quick and substantial reduction in the frequency of the RBD-related sleep events without side effects. So, you know, compelling, but again, only 4 patients. So here's another open-label observational study. So again, not a placebo-controlled trial. Here, this is an Israeli study where they looked at about 22 patients prior to smoking cannabis and then 30 minutes after smoking cannabis. They looked at a few different measures, including the Unified Parkinson's Disease Rating Scale, also known as the UPDRS. So this is the physical exam that every movement disorders neurologist will do for their Parkinson's patients at every visit, and it's assigned kind of a numerical score. It's helpful for studies like this. It's also helpful kind of for tracking progression of Parkinson's symptoms, and they looked at a few other scores as well. So this actually showed that patients did report an improvement in their UPDRS scores after smoking cannabis, and they specifically reported improvement in tremor and stiffness and slowness. So again, this is not a controlled study, but does show that patients felt like the cannabis subjectively helped some of their symptoms, and it just shows that it's something that deserves further study for sure. So here is a study from 2004. This is a randomized double-blind crossover study. So what that means is, you know, they had 19 patients in this study. About half of them took a placebo for 4 weeks, and then they had a 2-week washout period. And then after that, 4 weeks of the cannabis-containing product. And then the other group did the opposite, 4 weeks of cannabis, 2 weeks off, and then 4 weeks of placebo. And then this also looked at UPDRS scores, but also some quality of life scores. And unfortunately, despite the fact that cannabis was well tolerated, it was not found to have any pro or anti-Parkinsonian action. So it didn't make people better, but didn't make them worse. And there was also, unfortunately, no evidence that this that cannabis reduced levodopa-induced dyskinesia. So some conflicting evidence, although I think that this the quality of the study is a little bit higher than some of the survey studies previously. So this is one of our double-blind trial. This study looked at 21 patients with Parkinson's disease, and they put them in three different groups of seven. So one group of seven received placebo, one group got a low dose of cannabidiol, and then the third group got a high dose of the cannabidiol. And it looked at a few different measures, again, the UPDRS score, also a quality of life score, and then another indication or sort of a surrogate for whether or not this medication might be quote-unquote neuroprotective. And unfortunately, again, no statistically significant difference in the UPDRS score, so again, the severity of the Parkinson's symptoms, no significant difference in its ability to be neuroprotective, but the high dose cannabis group did show an improvement in their quality of life measures when compared to placebo. So again, a subjective improvement in patient symptoms, but nothing objective. So again, this is another study. This is another final survey study that I thought was interesting to show from the Czech Republic. And so basically, there was a survey sent out to many patients with Parkinson's disease, and this study focused on eight respondents who, seven of whom were regular users of cannabis-containing products. And it just shows here that only one reported an improvement in tremor, half reported an improvement in bradykinesia or slow movements, obviously the other half reported no change, three reported an improvement in rigidity, three reported an improvement in dyskinesia, only one reported an improvement in pain. So again, this is a subjective patient report, which is of course important, but even in these subjective studies, there's no way to draw a clear conclusion as to whether or not cannabis is effective in treatment of some of the symptoms. So just to sort of summarize these studies, cannabis may be helpful, it may not. It might help some of the motor symptoms, it may not. It might help some of the non-motor symptoms, and it may not. The positive studies were survey studies, so again, of lower quality than placebo-controlled trials. There's some suggestion that dyskinesia might improve. What we don't know is, does disease stage matter? So what if someone has early dyskinesia versus late dyskinesia after they're on a much higher dose of medication? And we also don't know what dose of cannabis should we really be using? Ultimately, we really can't draw any firm conclusions about whether it's good or bad. And so I've sort of taken the position that until we know conclusively that it's helpful, that I won't prescribe it. Now it is actually recreational in Illinois. So, patients are absolutely free to go and try it for themselves. On the topic of safety, the risk of abuse is actually quite low. There's estimates that show studies that estimate that 9% of users become addicted and experience some kind of withdrawal after quitting. We don't really know the mechanism, but likely it involves dopamine in some way, because dopamine, as we know, is also not just involved in Parkinson's, but also in kind of reward and anticipation or expectation. And then there's lots of potential adverse effects that have been reported. I don't need to kind of read each one, but these are not things that everybody has, like side effects of every medication. It really is often very much patient dependent. And then, of course, like other medications, some of the potential adverse effects might vary depending on the type of cannabis and the dose of cannabis that's been given. So the next question is often, well, how should I take it? Should I smoke it? Should I vape it? Should I use gummies? Again, we don't know. We do know that there's lots of different ways to ingest cannabis. We also don't know what dose to use. We don't know how bioavailable it is. That means, is every every 5 milligram tablet that you get going to be absorbed to the same extent? What about strain or type? And I can talk a little bit about that in a couple of slides. What about natural versus synthetic? So we really don't know. And as my Parkinson's patients know, I'm often tweaking the doses of their medications. So we really don't know how to do that effectively yet with the cannabis-containing products. I think we will, but when that's going to happen is harder to say. So this is another question that patients often ask, and I think this relates to one of the questions about sleep that that came up. So there's two different strains, sativa and indica. Sativa is considered better for daytime use because it kind of increases alertness, it's more uplifting, increases energy, which I think is interesting given that that's the strain that they gave in the sleep study, in that study that I mentioned. And the other type, the indica strain, is considered better for nighttime use, more relaxing, better as a sleep aid, considered better for pain relief. But I don't know necessarily that patients or users of marijuana would say strongly that they can tell a difference from one strain to the other. So what do we need? Where do we go from here? We need placebo-controlled trials, as I mentioned. We need the trials to use objective data that's not just patient-reported. We need accurate dosing information. We need to know how the medication behaves. What are the levels of cannabis in the blood, you know, after it's been ingested? Is it dose-dependent? Is there a delayed response after ingestion of the medication? And then we need to better assessments of how well it's tolerated. Does that depend on the stage of Parkinson's disease? Does it depend on other comorbidities? Should somebody with asthma or emphysema not smoke marijuana? You know, what strain should we use? These kinds of things. And then we need better education, but not just for patients, but for physicians like me, because I think that survey study that I mentioned at the beginning, where the movement disorders neurologists expressed their kind of confidence in which symptoms may or may not respond, or how much they know about use of cannabis is that's really a gap in our training, I think. And so I think as it becomes more ubiquitous, we're going to learn more and more of these things. So just to give a sense of the work that is being done, I know this is another small slide, but this is from clinicaltrials.gov, and I just took a screenshot of this yesterday. So these are eight, if you look up Parkinson's and cannabis, these are the eight studies that that come up. Certainly there's more studies being done, but this is just to give a sense to the patients that are really interested in this, that we are looking into it. It is an area of pretty robust research, and I think that, you know, it's moving pretty quickly. So I do think we'll know in the next few years a lot more about it, and we'll feel much more comfortable providing more kind of detailed recommendations to our patients as to whether or not it's recommended. So with that, I'll address a couple of the questions that were asked to me. So I think I touched on this briefly, but one patient submitted a question about cannabis and sleep. So again, it does look like it can help things like REM behavior sleep disorder. Anecdotally, I definitely have patients who say that either both THC-containing compounds or CBD-only containing compounds have been helpful for them in getting to sleep. You know, based on one of the final slides I showed, you know, the conventional wisdom would be to try an indica rather than a sativa if you're interested in what strain, because that's considered better for nighttime use. There was another question that was asked, which is unrelated to cannabis, and that was about pramipexole. And there's a relatively new warning that pramipexole can cause abnormal postures, so kind of being bent at the waist, or maybe what we call cervical dystonia, twisting of the head and neck. So there is definitely data that shows that long-term use of these medications, and in particular using these medications in people with long-standing disease, can increase the risk of these abnormal postures. Interestingly, another medicine that we often use called amantadine also has a similar kind of warning. In general, I think my patients would agree with this. I try to get people off of dopamine agonists as their disease progresses and as they get a little bit older, because there's lots of side effects that can develop once patients have been on these medications for a long time. But I think kind of generally what I would say about it, about that is that, you know, it's often difficult to tell in Parkinson's disease, are the side effects that people are experiencing because of the disease itself, or is it because of medications? And the answer is almost always it's from both, because you can get dystonia in Parkinson's disease whether or not you're on medication. You can get camptocormia, which is kind of that heavily or extremely stooped posture where patients are kind of bent forward at the waist without these medications. So certainly the data is compelling to show that these things can get worse, and there are even studies that show that it's dose responsive. So patients don't have the postures, and then once the meds have kicked in, the postures do exist. So certainly these medications make these postures worse, but it's a complex interaction between disease progression and the medications themselves. So that's it, and thank you.
Thank you for attending the Northwestern Medicine Parkinson's Summer Seminar Series hosted by Lake Forest Hospital. The Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital offers weekly exercise classes, a monthly support group, and activities including horseback riding and improv classes. In addition, we are proud to now offer access to clinical research trials through Northwestern Medicine. The Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital is completely donor-funded. Generous donations from individual community members support all of the programs and enable the program to expand. For more information about the Parkinson's program at Lake Forest Hospital, please contact Linda Egan, Parkinson's Program Coordinator, at 847-535-8244 or legan@nm.org.